Guess who's back? Back again. Crash is back. Tell a friend. Oh, wait, you don't have any friends. Ow! Well, how about instead of that, you listen up to this crazy, spooky thing that happened to me one time. It was a rainy November afternoon, and I was walking back from the park. I like to sit there and feed breadcrumbs to the ducks, then wait for them to get close and kick them. Serves them right for being able to swim and fly. Show-offs. I forgot my umbrella, so when the sky grew cloudy overhead, I knew I had to get home. Quickly. I tried emptying the remaining breadcrumbs out of the paper bag and sliding it over my head to keep my hair dry. Unfortunately, the bag disintegrated and my head just ended up smelling like wet yeast. More so than usual, that is. It's an ear infection thing, forget about it. Anyway, back on topic. I was walking quickly trying to get out of the rain when I sensed a sinister presence approaching me from behind. I clenched my butt cheeks and walked faster, my usual tactic. But this presence just would not give up. I looked over my shoulder and I swore I saw a hooded figure duck into a nearby alley. I picked up the pace, passing by a donut shop. Ooh, donuts. I stopped in there and bought a mixed box of four, all jam-filled. You may be thinking, he stopped for donuts when he was being pursued by a stalker? Yeah, I was scared for my life. But what good is living if you can't eat donuts? That's a lesson for you kids. I wolfed down the whole box and resumed walking home, still in the rain. The stalker was bolder now, closer than before. I hatched a cunning plan. I'd turn a corner and then wait for my stalker to turn the same corner and confront him. Or her. You never know. Could be a cute girl trying to get my number. Someone who saw the power of which I punt ducks with and just had to go out with me. I rounded the bend, did a 180 degree turn, and prepared to deal with whatever came my way. My adrenaline was pumping. I knew I had a leftover ice cream stick in my jacket pocket, but I doubted it would hold up as a weapon in a fight. Plus, I'd kept it because it said you're a winner, and I wanted to claim my free paddle pop next time I visited the corner store. If it broke in self-defense, though, it would be a fitting end for such a treasure. As I thought about what flavor a rainbow paddle pop actually is, it's caramel by the way, I realized the hooded figure was right in front of me. The figure was stunned. I was stunned. It was a stalemate of surprise. I approached, my breathing growing heavy. I can't explain why, but I felt drawn to this person. It was morbid curiosity. I raised my hand up to the figure's hood. I had to see their face. Then, quickly, I pulled it back. Nothing. No face, no head, nothing. And then I realized the hoodie was empty. I looked around myself to find that the street I had been standing on was gone. Instead, I was in the middle of a forest on a dirt track. The rain still poured down, and I was dripping wet. It was now nighttime, and the sound of nocturnal animals filled the air. Crickets chirping. What the actual? My thought was interrupted by a dog at my feet. Panting heavily. He looked like a Jack Russell Terrier to me, and trust me, I know my dogs. I spend weekends volunteering at the pound. Yeah, that's right. As much as culture likes to smack top me, I do actually try to help the community. And animals. Just not ducks. Or chickens. They can die a slow and painful death. I knelt down and picked up the perky pup. Looking into his eyes, images flashed through my head. A bolt of thunder. A muddy puddle. An unclipped leash. And someone's voice. Yelling, Franklin! Franklin! And I was looking back in the dog's eyes. I checked his collar. Franklin. I put two and two together. This dog must be Franklin. I'm a genius. I placed Franklin back on the ground, but he wouldn't leave me alone. He kept biting at the hoodie, nibbling at the edges. All right, I get it. This must be some alternate world where I have to help this dog, Franklin or whatever. Find his owner. Then, and only then, can I return to my world. I'd seen and heard enough paranormal stories before to piece it together, but quite frankly, I couldn't care less. I just wanted to get on with my day, but no. Some creepy spirit world had to abduct me and make me solve its scary story. And I mean, really, Franklin? As a dog's name? What is this world coming to, dagnabbit? Unfortunately, it didn't seem there was an easy way out of this world. I tried running down the dirt track, but the scenery just kept repeating. And this yipping dog kept following me, completely unaware of just how little I wanted to help it. I stopped running after about 30 seconds because I got a stitch. I really should lay off of the donuts once in a while. In any case, I realized if I wanted to get back to my nice warm room with my glowing computer screen that slowly degrades my corneas into cloudy discs, I would need to help Franklin find his owner. Or actually, on closer inspection, her owner. Serious! Seriously, people, who named this dog? Okay, time to put my detective hat on. Literally, I always keep it in my pocket for emergencies like these.
It seemed as though Franklin's owner had been walking her through this forest when a thunderstorm came through. Spooked by the lightning, Franklin must have bolted off, pun intended, leaving her owner in the mud. But if that's the case, shouldn't her owner still be on the path somewhere looking for her? I examined the repeating area carefully for clues. Aha! The muddy puddle I'd seen. And footprints leading off the track and into the forest. Looks like it's time for me to go bushwhacking. I pushed aside branches and stepped over logs, following the trail of disturbed shrubbery to find Franklin's owner. Franklin had decided to float while following me. What with being a spooky dog in a dream world after all. This ability would have been scarier if she didn't have such a stupid-looking face. She couldn't even manage to keep her tongue in her mouth. Instead, she just had this blep, where the tip of her tongue poked out through her lips. Though her spirit-like qualities did raise a good question, what had happened to her? Had she died after running off from her owner? Was her owner dead as well? Maybe I'd get to see some grisly corpse or something before this was all over. That'd be kinda whacked out, yo. Huh. The promise of a gore-filled spectacle drew me further into the forest. Finally, I came upon a clearing. In the middle of this dense forest was a log cabin. I could see a white, glowing light inside. I'd have to be careful how I approached this creepy cabin. Who knows whether it contains friend or foe. Before I had time to ready myself, however, the hoodie in my hand began to pull, straining towards the cabin as though pulled by some invisible force. I let go instinctively and it flew into the wall of the cabin, sticking to it as though by static electricity. The white light inside suddenly went out. Someone inside knew I was here. Okay, come on, really, at least give me a chance here. I'm trying to be all sneaky and stuff, but when a random magical power just pulls the hoodie out of my hand and blows my cover, what am I supposed to do? Then Franklin starts barking like it's the frickin' 4th of July or something and runs over as well, turning this covert operation into a lollapalooza. Knock, 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 it's the police! Open up! I couldn't help myself. How often do you get to say that line? There was no response. I knocked again. Knock, knock, knock! Okay, okay, it's not the police. I'm looking for this dog's owner. No response. Then, in the wimpiest little voice I've ever heard, whoever was inside was clearly frightened. How dare they be frightened? I'm the one who gets to be frightened. This is my spooky story. I used my rage like my papa taught me to and kicked in the door. Well, I say kicked in, it was actually already unlocked. But still, pretty impressive, am I right, ladies? Cowering behind the settee was a tiny, bald man. Gross. The settee was lovely. The man, not so much. He had shrunken little eyes that threatened to pop out of existence if they got any smaller, and the shine off his head. I mean, whoa, NASA could probably put this guy on the moon and bounce lasers off him for their experiments. But the worst part about him was his teeth. Little yellow grains of rice. I felt like I could pop them out by blowing on them. Not that I would, because it'd be really totally gross blowing into another person's mouth. Another one of my senses was being assaulted at the same time. The smell in here was god-awful. Imagine if you dipped rancid meat in a stew made from boiled gym socks and you might have something 10 times weaker than what this guy's house smelled like. It was a festival for the nose, except the festival had gone horribly wrong and fireworks were shooting into the crowd, and there was a little kid like, "Mummy, mummy!" It was all I could do to keep from throwing up. But that damn dog seemed just fine. She padded over to the bald man who scurried away, retreating around the couch. The dog jumped on him, licking his face eagerly. Imagining what that guy must taste like sent another wave of nausea through me.
Get off, get off!
The bald man screamed, being harassed by Franklin. I stepped inside a little further and the source of the smell became apparent. This man had created his own little hovel designed purely for watching TV. He had a massive 88-inch cock! It was glorious! I joke. He had a massive 88-inch... I keep going to say cock, what's wrong with me? He had a massive 88-inch QLED TV setup, and in front of it, a worn leather recliner that had clearly seen better days. But the smell. Stacks upon stacks of snacks upon snacks. Biscuits, potato chips, chocolate bars, gummy worms, you name it. It was there. And then, behind that, garbage bags of rotting leftovers. So many as to block out whatever sunlight might come in through the cabin's window. He had created a cave of filth to hide from the outside world. The bald man tried to squirm his way back through his trash wall, but Franklin grabbed at his pant leg and dragged him back out. He was so weak that even a puppy was able to manhandle him. Pathetic. Franklin sniffed, then suddenly leapt into a box nearby. He pulled out an item from one of my visions. The leash. Franklin sat in front of the bald man, leash in mouth.
No, no, dear God, no!
The scene in front of me, this tableau of submission, I couldn't understand. And then it clicked. Franklin wanted a walk. Okay, that much was obvious, but hear me out. This bald man had stopped taking Franklin for walks, becoming more and more entrenched in his sedentary ways. His body had twisted, deformed into this disgusting figure before me from lack of sunlight, poor diet, and little exercise. No doubt the blinding white light I saw earlier was from his gigantic TV, which had shriveled his eyes into the black olives they were now. The images I saw. A bolt of thunder, a muddy puddle, an unclipped leash. This bald man didn't lose Franklin. He let her go on purpose so that he could cut ties with his one remaining obligation to go outside. Just one question remained. Why should I care? Yeah, this guy is some weird, sad loser, but I have other stuff to worry about. I've got my life to get back to. Things to do, An empty Dorito bag was knocked loose by the bald man and floated towards me, landing in my hands. I looked down and then looked back. The withered bald man.
Oh no. That's me. This man is what I'm turning into. The path I'm headed down. He's my ghost of Christmas future. My life of shoveling down snack foods and burying my head in video games is all leading up to this disgusting future. I felt a sense of dread come over me. A dark, knowing fear that sucked in from my very core. I looked up. Franklin was in front of me, leash in his mouth. Her eyes were pitch black. She barked an inhuman sound. The garbage bags around me began to bulge outwards and erupted with worms and maggots. They crawled towards me. I was paralyzed. They surrounded me, crawled all over me. The lights went out. Then I was standing back on the street corner. There was no hoodie. No bald man. No Franklin. I blinked hard, rubbing my eyes. A dream? I took a step, but my foot squished as it lifted. I had stepped in a dog turd. It was no dream. I don't know what mystical forces had conspired to send me into that creepy world, but I got their message loud and clear. I was on the path to self-destruction. Unless I changed my ways, I would sink into a sad state of self-loathing where I smelt like a sewage pipe. The sun had come out. I was no longer dripping wet. I grabbed a stick and scraped the waste off my shoe. Today was the start of a new me. Anyway, all that was like 6 months ago. Since then, I've watched and rewatched all of The Crown and played more hours of Fortnite than I can even count. No spooky dog is gonna stop me from living my life the way I want to. What can I say? I'm a creature of habit. See y'all next week! Well, no, not next week. Like, in the next 2 weeks, because the schedule changed, didn't it? It's like an episode every 2 weeks now? Yeah, I'm certain, every 2 weeks.
If you enjoy what we do here at Culture Crash, please consider supporting the show via our Patreon, where we have a bunch of awesome rewards, or by checking out our online store. All links are in the description below.